CCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host tonight. And with me this evening, I have the poet Noah Ayala. I'm going to start off with a piece of poetry that Noah tells me has really, really impressed him a lot. And this is by Nasir Jones, a rap poet. So here we go. But what's it all worth? Can't take it with you under this earth. Rich men died and tried, but none of it worked. They just robbed your grave. I'd rather be alive and paid. Before my number's called, history's made. Some will fall, but I rise, thug or die. Making choices that determine my future under the sky. To rob, steal, or kill? I'm wondering why. It's a dirty game. Is any man worthy of fame? Much success to you, even if you wish me the opposite. Sooner or later, we'll all see who the prophet is. So you hear Noah Ayala joining me on that last line. So Noah, your influences are largely from hip-hop.
Definitely.
And you were telling me out in the lobby that that started around age 10 when you moved up from Puerto Rico. And the hip-hop culture, excuse me, is a little different from the typical poets that we have on camera here at Poets Pause. So I'm just going to give the audience some sort of idea of what hip-hop is like. Now, you've styled yourself as what's called an MC. And, in my language, that means master of ceremonies. And in hip-hop culture, that's the same meaning, but your objective is to hype up the crowd and get everybody interested in what's going on. I would tell you that one of the things that we have loved about you at Berks Bards is you have that connection, immediate connection with the audience. And your stuff is good, but just the way you reach out and make sure everybody's here, everybody's paying attention, we're all involved, is just wonderful. So anyway, that aside, let's talk about what got you actually physically writing and in a class with our poet laureate, Craig Churi.
I think for me, I just needed to escape my everyday reality and be who I was supposed to be. And I never thought that poetry, the way I write it now, was going to be the way it is now, because I was always a hip-hop head. But when I first took the class, I took the class with the purpose of, let me find another way to express myself if nobody's going to respect hip-hop the way I respect it. You know, in my head, I felt like everybody was stepping on it, thought it was a violent thing, thought it was, you know, by choice. You know, for some of us, it's something that's inside, you know what I mean? And it says, this is a part of my culture, this is a part of my struggle. People think that hip-hop is like a style, you know, and it's more like a way of life. You know, I've been through the pain, I've been through hardships, I've been through losses, I've been poor, I've been good.
Well, and if I could address that for just one moment, one of the things that you told me was that when you entered this class, you were all prepared for it to be like something you couldn't relate to.
I didn't think I was going to relate to it at all.
And then you started meeting people like Annika Russell, I think her full name is. I forget the last name. Forgive me if I said the wrong last name. And you did found out about her struggle.
And her struggle was real.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I said,
well, yours is too.
But I said, whoa, I can't believe, you know, I was wrong, you know, for judging people in a way that I wouldn't want to be judged. You understand? Like, I feel like All these people are looking at me funny, maybe because I got baggy jeans and army fatigues on, but they don't understand my struggle. And then when I sat there and opened up with the peers that were in the classroom, you know, I found out that my mentor has been 15 years on the road. I found out that Annika has been through a history moment, you know, a moment in history where it's like nobody could ever know what that individual felt like, you know? So I'm like, wow, we're all the same. And with hip hop, that culture is people that all come from the same and want the same exit. They just want to let it out. Whether it's dance, whether it's DJing, whether it's MCing, b-boying, or even graffiti, even tagging up a mural on the wall. You know, a lot of people see it as vandalism. To them people, they see it as an expression, a way out, you know, a way to let their soul breathe, you know, mm-hmm. a way to be accepted for who they are, you know. So when I look at it as art. I look at it like, wow, this is what hip-hop created. How can it ever die? How can it ever go away? So I make sure that people know, yeah, I represent hip-hop. I love hip-hop.
Well, I would like to pause right now and hear some of your stuff because... You know, I like your stuff.
Thank you.
And so I want to share that. And, you know, we could talk forever, but let's get some of this stuff in.
All right. So this piece right here is kind of called My Muse. It's kind of more or less about what is it? Why do I do what I do? What is the battle in between my flesh and my soul? You know what I'm saying? It's not too long, so I'm going to start off with this piece. I left the stage but still had something to say. I wasn't done yet. I wanted to speak about love. I wanted to comment on hate. I wanted to scream, but through the silence I can hear the wind break. A pin drop. I feel like a needle in a haystack, stacked way back in a way that nobody will find me. I spoke bluntly but blindly, and what I mean is the applause from the audience blinds me. The light is bronze in the pale reflection of my skin. I swear that every time I speak, it's not me, but a force so strong within me, it resides deep beyond my existence. What can I say if my mind doesn't understand my soul's persistence, or if my own eyes have never witnessed my physical's existence? There's a distance, an unspoken resistance between us, between me and my muse. And I don't mean to sound confused, but it's that fire within me that lights that fuse. Countless times I've laid back and watched it all infuse. Can I please have a moment of silence? No, not now, because right now that would be the wrong thing to do. And I don't have all the answers, but these writings help reveal the clues. Plus, that silence is more respected when that silence comes from you, my muse.
Very good. Thank you. And you know, going back to the poem that the piece of poem that I read in the intro, Nas is like that was taken from his piece. What strikes me is that piece, even though the section I read was very reflective about you know what are we doing here on Earth. It had started with this whole business, and you're going to know who I'm talking about. Remember Ahademe and I Am a Poet?
My man. My man.
And he's out of that hip-hop culture, too. And spoken word artist. And this one by Nasir Jones is the beginning is like, oh, Nas is like earth, wind, and fire,
like
rims and tires, bulletproof glass inside of the realest driver, planets in orbit. I mean, he's describing himself. He's describing himself in these big terms. And then it's like, why am I here? You know, because it's all going to go.
Yeah. And it doesn't matter what you do here to get money. Once you're gone, all they're going to do is rob your grave.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Everybody's going to live off of it. So that's why expressing yourself pays off a lot more. Because God forbid something, whatever happened to me or any of my friends that are poets, I'm always going to be able to read what they wrote And what I'm always going to be able to see it in a new way and say, oh, maybe they meant this.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that lives on.
Like you can keep talking to them when they're gone.
That's it. Hey, listen, I listened to that Nas is like, I was young. I was probably like 14, 15 years old when that came out. And I listened to that today and it sounds the same way it did 15 years ago.
Now, for you, it's very important to reach out to young people.
Yes, it definitely is.
You and I both shared an experience down at Abraxas.
Yes.
Academy. And it was neat because one of the young ladies who was there, who went down with us as an instructor to these young men who had been basically incarcerated in a high school. It's a detention center, and she one of the kids challenged her to spit, and she said, "Yeah, you want to spit? I can spit." And I was like, "What?
What is spitting?
What does that mean?" And of course, you know, that means I can do a poem right now.
We can go back and forth.
Say it right out. So, would you spit another one, please?
Would I spit another one? I got you. How do you want it? That's the question. Like, to me, if life was pain, it'd be like the rain, but it would be unstoppable. Untoppable because you couldn't change it or have it in any other way. I slay my pen left to right. Every night before I go to sleep, I write. I possess something so deep inside that I gotta strive for more. It's like a war that I fight within myself. And sometimes it's even bad for my health. But if I endure it, my brain would just melt in pain and sorrow. Or maybe my life would just drain in a bottle, I don't know. But I speak for today, I can't speak for tomorrow because I need these youngins to follow. I want to be that person for them that wasn't there for me. I want to be that one graffiti artist that'll tag it up on the wall to help them see. I want to be the one to say, you can be whatever you want to be. That's the job of an MC off the top.
Very good. Okay. Now, we were talking earlier about walking into the Goggle Works and what that was like for you and how you feel about how it's in the neighborhood, but that city kids don't go there.
I don't know what it is. I love the Goggle Works. I don't know what it is, but I feel like it arrived in a very impoverished part of our city. A lot of youngins might not feel accepted there, or might not feel, they might feel exactly the same way I did when I walked into a classroom and I looked around and I said, I don't want to be judged, you know? Because being a hip hop head or being from the streets or being coming up in a hard life, you know, some people say, you know what, I'd rather not walk that route because this is the route I'm comfortable going. So, you know, it could be within the people or it could be that it was a tree that grew out of concrete. You know what I mean? And it's scary because not everybody's going to eat from his fruit, no matter how good it looks. You know, I think that there has to be a lot more community involvement when it comes to an art center, especially when you're trying to reach the inner city kids. See, that's the difference. We need the inner city kids to be involved in these positive art movements. Not the outer city. They're welcome too.
And they'll get it.
But they'll be there.
They'll get it.
They'll be there. But if it was for non-city residents, then it should have been built in a non-city residence.
But it's not.
But it's not. And it's a blessing. I've been there and I've met a lot of beautiful people. My life has changed a lot in the art form. And I've done a lot of things that I never would have done if I would have never walked through them doors. You know, I've taken over a lot of insecurities that I had by saying, you know what? God only gave me one life, and he only gave me one voice. So I got to find ways in Reading, PA, how I can express that and still live my daily life, still pay bills, still be a father, still be a husband, still be a son. You know, so I'm happy the place is there. I just wish that it had a lot more city involvement.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Well, and as a person who's done programming in the libraries in the whole county, I get a tremendous amount of involvement with a program I called Write a Poem Right Now. And basically, we're putting little prizes into every library in the county. And I get a tremendous amount of involvement from the Wyomissing Library. They get kids, they must pour in there by the thousands writing poems.
How about our kids?
But our kids? Oh, boy, that's hard. Now, you know, let's be fair. Some of the branch libraries don't have long hours. They have very limited hours.
Very true.
But I'm not getting the kind of involvement in the written arts, the language arts, that I want to see, considering the population, the size of the population. And I know for you, your next job essentially is to write a book, and you're hoping to approach the Reading School District and get them to allow you to be on campus and to reach out to kids. I know you've done this kind of stuff with iLead, and you've certainly been to the Children's Home of Reading and the Second Street Shelter. So you're building that resume that says I'm the person, and I know how connected you are and how wonderful your work is. So anyway, let's do some more of your poetry because we're going to be running out of time. I'm hoping you'll do the one about your car.
Oh, you want to hear that one?
I love
All right,
that
so
one.
Hopefully we got time for two. I want to read about my city. But yeah, I'm a mechanic. Some people know, some people don't. And it was a crazy experience. And I always get that. Oh, you men in your cars. You know, so I wrote this little piece. What do you mean we take care of our cars more than our women? It was then the thought crossed my mind. If women were cars. If women were cars, it probably wouldn't be so hard to jumpstart your heart. You would give me warmth when in need. In the summer, you keep me cool with your breeze. In the rain, you wipe the tears. Your paint would fade from all the years united. You would reflect my safety from all your mirrors. But even through all that, I still would take care of the ride of my life, my daily driven. None could compare. I'd keep you to myself. I would never, ever, ever, ever share. Two seats next to each other, never meant to be alone. You would always manage to get me lost trying to find this way home. Watching the world go by through your windshield's eyes, it'd be so hard to part ways. Hopefully you last the winter's pain, cause being parked, you'd rust away to reach my point of destination. Yet we move another day to my daily driven.
I love that.
I love cars.
And I'm gonna let you keep going. You read us your stuff.
All right. I have a piece that I recently wrote, and it means a lot to me, just because I'm a city slicker. You know, I definitely love the city, and I always will. It's part of who I am. But, and being that I love this beautiful city so much, I've seen a lot of things here that I dislike. So this piece is called Across Town. Across town lately, everything seems so fixed, so orchestrated, so well put. It's like a giant carefully places all the pieces nice and neat while we deep in our sleep, like every step we take was deliberately put there for our souls to follow. These streets will swallow you whole, believe it. Across town lately, everything seems so gray. Strange clouds with pineapple mango rays burning through the sunshades, creating different hues. These streets created me all while fading you. a product of a product. I'd hate it too. Gazing at the broken windows that project back blocks surrounded by galvanized fences with padded locks. Across town lately, you need more than just words as weapons. A place notoriously known for Girl Scouts selling Thin Mints and drug dealers selling they dope. Poets speaking they words and corrupt politicians selling they hope. That rock that was painted peace is now just a covered slope. Across town lately, ain't nothing seem right. A 15-year-old boy dies of a razor blade to his windpipe. A man gets robbed for a nickel and then loses his life. While the pretty boys get fades every 3 days concerning they don't look right. Their faces against the glass living the opposite of this life. Looking from the outside in, it doesn't seem right. A slight change to the window pane as the wind blows shame. The gray clouds shout once again, here come the rain. The storm of grief followed by the shower of pain. Have you ever lost a brother to a gunshot? Have you ever been chased by cops through 12 city blocks or slept in a cracked spot even though you knew it was hot? Probably not. Some live in fear of daily life. Some sleep but never turn out the lights. Others beg at the end of the barrel for just one more day of life. Across town lately, I've seen blood and more. I've seen neighbors locked inside their houses, scared to open a doors. I've seen the rain clear our polluted streets and wash the trash ashore. I've seen a homeless man outside begging for change as the snow poured. I've seen the city and its council close its doors all because we spoke and we needed more. I've seen meter maids give tickets all because they're bored. I've seen people in need to be straight ignored. I've seen grown men laying on the pavement with blankets of cardboard and buildings in perfect conditions to be covered in boards. It's like the rich get high while they glut and they hoard. One question. What does one man need all these buildings for? Need I say more? Across town.
Keep going. You got another one.
I got you. And long. I got a piece for you.
We got about 2 minutes, and while you're hunting, I'll just say, come to first Thursday of the month, 6 to 8 p.m. in the Goggle Works on the first floor. Open mic poetry, we'd love to have you.
Yeah, we have one at Custom and Print.
Oh, that's right.
Yep, every first Saturday, we do spoken word, we do improv. It's on 4th Street right now. I'm blurry. I think it's 24 South 4th Street. It's right off of Penn Street. It's called Custom and Print. But we have something going on there too, so you guys are more than welcome. This piece is called Blind Eye. It's really short.
Okay.
But it's just
hopefully we got enough time.
No standards here. Just points of view. It's the only way you can see it out someone else's mind. My eyes gather thoughts just in case I go blind. If I were to ever reach this day, I would just press rewind over and over again to the instrumentals and let them play in my mind so I could recall the visions of vivid colors that were once projected opposite of the pitch black world that we now live in. I didn't lose control. I gained control of a sixth sense while losing my fifth. My choosing is this. Hip-hop, a direct order to my soul's voice. While the tears run moist, I think I'm blind to the fact that I'm losing my vision. Blind eye.
Very good. Thank you so much, Noah Ayala. And I reiterate my invitation to come out for First Thursday, and you have First Saturday.
Every first Saturday of the month, we do that
open mic. How many people are you getting?
25, something like nice. That. It just depends. But we've been kind of switching it up. We've been doing a little bit of improv. We've been doing a little bit of ciphers back and forth. So people just tell them, hey, you got to spit. You got to spit.
All right. And we're done with this evening. We'll see you next month. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Marilyn.
Thank you.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.